Well, good morning. Thank you so much. Am I loud or am I just okay? I'm all right. Okay. All right. It's a privilege to come to your church every year. Last year we weren't here, and my wife is not with me this year. She's not feeling too good. I think Pastor Ken told you that she fell again and hurt her brain stem, but she's at home in Texas, not in a home in the RV. And we just would appreciate your prayer that you'll agree with us that God will touch her and get her out of that attack from the enemy, okay? Just because we're preachers doesn't mean that we cannot be attacked. We're going to be attacked as well. Is that good? All right, for those of you that don't know me, I'm from South Africa. I was born in South Africa, me and my wife and my daughter. And we're now in America. We travel all over America doing mission work and evangelizing work. So that's why we're here, to come and preach to you this morning and give you the same gospel that you know, but just with a real English accent. I see some of you looking at me with those funny eyes again. You're thinking, what on earth am I hearing? You're just hearing real English, that's all. It's not Californialish, it's English. You guys speak different than we do, you know. I don't know why, but it's good. We love it. Well, we're going to do three songs quickly, just to worship God this morning, because your praise team put me in the position to sing it, and I don't have my equipment yet. So Randy's going to do the sound, so if it doesn't sound good, look at Randy. Everybody look at the back and say, hey, no. That's okay, Randy, you'll be good. Would you stand with us this morning, and let's start worshiping the Lord. Okay. Thank you, Father God. Randy, when I sing, you're going to give me some effects. Am I right? Is it right? Thank you, Lord. Okay. Oh, yes, Lord, you're a good God this morning. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. I worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Come on, let's bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, I worship His holy name. Sing like never before. I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Come on, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord,
oh my soul. Oh my soul, I worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore.
let's bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, I worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, I worship His holy name. Sing like never before. I worship Your holy name. Yes, I worship Your holy name. Yes, I will. I worship Your holy name.
Come on, give the Lord a big clap this morning. We worship You this morning, God. Hallelujah. He's a mighty God. He saves and He heals. Yes, Lord. And everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. And everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Lord, You're a Savior this morning. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Yes, Lord, we thank You this morning. So take me as You find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Yes, I surrender, Lord. Come on, church, sing. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, He's the author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine Your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine Your light and let the whole world sing. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Yes, Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Yes. Thank You, Lord, that You conquered the grave. You're a Savior. You're a healer. Give Him another clap this morning. Praise the Savior. Praise the healer.
And he's a good and an awesome and a mighty God. Amen. You guys are doing good this morning. Huh? That's great. Yes, thank you, Lord. We give you all the praise this morning, God.
The splendor of a king is clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. Now he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. And it trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Age to age he stands, time is in his hand, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. Come on, sing. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? Don't we see how great is our God?
Sing it again. How great
is our God. Sing with me, how great
is our God.
And oh, see how great is our God.
Come on, this sings my soul.
My Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul,
my Savior God.
Church, lift your voice, sing it one more time. Tell him he's a great God. Oh yes, you are.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, we see how great is our God.
Come on, one more time, sing.
How great, yes, is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. And oh, we see how great is our God.
Praise this morning. Come on. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Come, Pastor Kane, are you around somewhere? Yeah, are you ready?
Hello. Hello. Good morning. Can we share a pulpit for a second? Is that fine? Let's get right over here. Good morning. Good morning, precious saints. How we doing? Fantastic. Oh, goodness. So, God bless you guys. If you are new here today, we would like you to fill out one of these cards, legibly, please, and turn it in. And it's good for a free pumpkin pie today. Seriously? Oh, my. Yeah, that's back there in the Solid Rock Cafe. So you're more than welcome to. And stick around. We'd love to get to know you a little bit. So we'll go through this bulletin here. Men's Bible study this Tuesday. We are in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Also, we are halfway through the 40 days of prayer for life. I guess several clinics have already been closed, and over 200 babies have been saved at this point. So that's a praise the Lord. That's fantastic. So keep it up. Halfway through, right? You know, it seems like every day has its own day, correct? You know, they all have their own days, right? Well, yesterday was hit your finger with a hammer day, and so I got it pretty good. Okay, that was yesterday. That was good. Today, November 2nd is designated International Prayer Day for the Persecuted Church. So we know it's really getting dark out there across the world, so put that on your calendar. That's important. November 9th is the Night to Honor Israel to be held for free at Trinity Life Center, 7 p.m. to 9, and there is a card if you need more information on that. Reminder, online giving is now available at our church website, so that's there for you. Ladies, sign-ups for Secret Sisters Ministry will conclude next Sunday. I believe my wife still has to do it. I'm going to embarrass her over here. So you have a little bit more time, people, to do that, ladies. There's a form back there on the table. Let's see and see Sissy King if you have any questions for that. Operation Christmas Child, they're back there in the back. The boxes are put together for us. That is coming. That's coming up really quick. So now is the time to buy your toys and your toiletry items to put in those. And as you probably know already, they send these boxes into war-torn areas of the world where there's hell on earth, basically. And they give these to kids, and they spread the gospel at the same time. So it's definitely a wonderful thing. So that is coming up. So get on it, people. We're running out of time for that one. If you're interested in being baptized, there's a sign up in the foyer back there, and so you need to get on that as well and speak to Pastor Ken, because that's coming up real quick. Although there's not a date on that, correct? No, okay. Also, the next men's breakfast is coming up, November 1st, 8 a.m. Is that this next? That's 2 weeks from now, is it not? I don't know the date. The Mortgage Building Fund is at 963 presently. And I think that is all. Please, if the ushers can come up for this morning's offering. And of course, we're overjoyed that Hansie's here to bless us. Fantastic. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for Hansie coming here, and we just thank you for your many blessings, Father. We also thank you for this time that we can give back to you just a little bit of what you've given to us. We ask you to use it for your glory, and bless us, your people. You already have, and you continually do so. And so we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm going to, is this thing on?
Okay. I'm just going to sing one song from our CDs out there. And I have a table there with the Armor of God book. I think I preached that in your church last time I was here. Wrote a book about it. Go and buy it, $10, to see how you can put on the Armor of God practically in your life. There's some Jesus caps there that people are buying, and we got some CDs with our music on. Most of you have got the music because I've been here so many years already. We're busy trying to get a new CD out with all the songs we've written. It just costs a lot of money to do it, okay? The economy is not what it should be, so we're just trusting God to help us. If it wasn't for Jesus, where would you be this morning? Don't know about you, but I would most probably be dead after all the drugs and the alcohol that I went through and the rock bands. Most of you know I played in these rock bands with long hair down here. Perm, man, just one day God just saves me and sets me free. So that's what my thought life is about. I think about Jesus, boy. I think about what he did for me and how he died for me and how he loves me, and I want to return that to him. So let me sing you a song this morning about how Jesus died, but he rose again and he's alive. Amen. Okay. If you can, yeah, right, they'll be back. Boy, you're doing good. Just don't give me a fright. Think about the cross and the blood that was shed. I think about your side and the thorns on your head. I think about your feet and the holes in your hands. And I see the stripes on your back, and I know it was done for me. Think about the blind man and how you made him see. I think about the woman with blood and how you set her free. I think about the lame man, how you told him to walk. And I see the stripes on your back, and I know it was done for me. Yes, I know it was done for me. And it was all done to make me whole. And every drop of blood to save my soul. And it was all done to set me free. Every cry, all the pain to make me see Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. And it was all done to clear my name. Every stripe, all the shame, to make me see Jesus loves me. Yes, he does. Jesus loves me. Oh, yes, Lord. Thank you, God. Think about him dying, how he rose the third day. I think about the empty tomb, how the stone was rolled away. I think about what he said, death can't keep me down. And I see Jesus coming back, and I know it's for you and me. Think about heaven
and the river of life. I think about the golden streets and the everlasting lights. I think about the throne of God where the angels sing. And I see Jesus coming back, and I know it's for you and me. Yes, I know it's for you and me. And it was all done to make me whole, and every drop of blood to save my soul. And it was all done to set me free. Every cry, all the pain, to make me see that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. And it was all done to clear my name. Every stripe, all the shame, to make me see that Jesus loves me. Yes, he does. Jesus loves me. Every cry, all the pain, every stripe, all the shame, for you and me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Every cry, all the pain, it was done for you and me.
What a great God we serve. Amen. Yep. Man, it's always good to come to you. I love Pastor Ken, and I love Leslie, and I love the children, and I love a lot of you guys that I know. I can't remember everybody's names. I can see some of the familiar faces and some of the more mature faces now. Some of you have got different color hair than you had last year, and so do I. And I told the people, we had a service yesterday afternoon. Told the people, my wife one morning got up and I was in the trailer and I was standing underneath the light. She said, oh, you got sparkles in your hair. And I felt like sparkles in my hair. It's gray hair. Why don't you just say gray hair? She says, I love your sparkles. I said, yeah, you're an undercover blonde. You just put on some color in your hair, but you're undercover blonde, man. Now listen, I think by now you guys know me. I've been coming here for years. So as a missionary or a evangelist or whatever they want to call me, I just pop in and do one service, all right? So we're not following I think Pastor's in Hebrew. Are you in Hebrew? All right, so I'm going to go totally different. Where is Ken? Is he still around here? Is he just left? He doesn't listen to me? Well, that's really hurting my ego now. That's okay. Let's just pray. Lord, we thank you this morning for the people coming. Thank you that they are here because they want to hear the word of God. Thank you that you'll help people this morning. The word of God is so powerful. And thank you that, Lord, I can preach this word this morning through the power of the Holy Spirit, that people will not listen to man, but they will listen to Jesus, the word. God's word. Thank you that they will listen through the Holy Spirit and not their fleshly ears, because then they won't get hold of it. And help me to preach through the Holy Spirit and not my flesh, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, turn your Bibles with me to the book of Luke, chapter 18. Now, I know they're going to have it on there as well. And then Marianne, am I right, Marianne? Okay, if something's wrong up there, it's not my fault, it's Marianne's fault. I always tell the people that do the words, if you're wrong or you're right, it doesn't matter. You're always wrong. Let's just read a portion of Scripture. Luke chapter 18, verse 18, and read it. It says, now there was a certain ruler, and they asked Jesus, saying, good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? So they're asking Jesus how to get saved. So Jesus said to them, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother. Just stop right there. Isn't it incredible? The guy's asking Jesus how to get saved. You know what? Jesus said, you know what to do. You know the commandments. In our lives, sometimes we do things wrong, and we say, Lord, what do I have to do? We know what to do. We know the right thing, what to do, but we just don't do it always. Uh-huh. Don't sit there, just say, mm-hmm, now then. I know that I'm preaching to live people, okay? All right. he says, honor your mother and your father. And then he said, so the man turns around after this and says, Jesus, all these commandments or all these things I've kept from my youth. Now, I don't know if this young man was just bragging or if he had really kept all these commandments. How do we know? It doesn't say. Whichever way, Jesus was going to get him, size him down to size. So when Jesus heard these things, that the man said he's kept all these commandments, he said to him, there's still one thing that you need to do that you're lacking. He says, sell all that you have, distribute it to the poor, and you will have treasures in heaven, and then come and follow me. But when the young man heard this, he became very sorrowful before he was very rich. Okay, so now a lot of people use this scripture and they say, see, Jesus told the man to sell all his stuff and give everything away because Jesus doesn't want nobody to have money. Is that true? No, that's not true. God doesn't want you to be poor. He wants you to drive a nice Chevrolet truck. He wants you to have a nice house. He wants you most probably won't be a millionaire, but there's no ways that Jesus was telling this guy, give away everything because I don't want people to be rich. There are rich people that serve God, okay? But look at this guy. Look what's happening here. This guy, when he heard that he had to give away everything and serve Jesus, he didn't want to do this. Look at me quickly. Because his number one was his riches. And God and Jesus saying to him, take away your number one and make me number one. So can I ask you this morning, is Jesus Christ number one in your life this morning? Or is your golf number one in your life? Or are you going to get up 12 o'clock and say, I've got to go and watch Dallas Cowboys lose? Because that's your number one. What is the number one in your life this morning? Is your job? Is your money? Is your television? Is your cell phone? Is that, you know what I'm saying? Because as soon as we start doing that, we idolizing other stuff. You know, well, we might have a service tomorrow night because it's Monday night. Who knows? But no, I cannot come because I'm going to watch Dancing with the Stars. You see, understand what I'm saying? I think God wants us to make him number one, and then the rest. This situation to me was like, all right, if this guy had given everything away, I believe God would have blessed that guy double, just like he did with Job. When Job lost everything, God blessed him double. But this guy wasn't prepared to give everything away, and God and Jesus were testing me. Are you going to follow me, or is your stuff more important? All right. So, and when Jesus saw that, he became very sorrowful, and he said to the people, how hard it is for those, now listen to what he said, who has riches. So let me put it the other way. How hard it is for those people who put other things number one and not me. In this man's case, it was his money, his riches, all right? So that's why Jesus is saying, how hard it is for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God. For it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Or for somebody else that puts anything else number one and puts God number two. It's going to be hard. I'm not saying it. That's what the word said. Jesus said, if you put something else number one, your riches or your anything else above God, boy, it's going to be hard for you to go to heaven. I don't know. I'm not God. I cannot say people want to go to heaven or not. But listen to me. I'm going to make God number one in my life so that I know I'm going to go to heaven. Amen? All right. So, and those people that were around this, hearing this whole story, boy, I can just see some of them saying, oh boy, if this rich young man, which is a good guy, and he's kept all the commandments, the only thing he doesn't want to do is give up his riches, which he's worked for so many lives. And now Jesus is saying, I don't think you're going to make heaven, boy, if you do this. The people around then they said, well, then who can be saved? If this guy cannot get saved, how am I going to get saved? And what a dumb question to ask. Because you cannot compare yourself with other people. Am I right? You see some people getting healed and other people don't get healed. And you see other people lose their business, which is paying tithes, and you don't lose your business. Or they don't lose their business and you lose your business. And they go bankrupt and you don't. And we start comparing each other with each other. And never ever do that, because you don't know other people's situations. You don't know what this young man's heart was, okay? So, but the people are saying, well, if he cannot get saved, how can we get saved? And then Jesus comes out with the next scripture, which is such an incredible scripture. Jesus said, listen, the things which are impossible with man are possible with God. And I want to preach on that verse this morning. I want to ask you this morning, is there something in your life that's impossible that you cannot fix? Come on, only you know that. I have my impossibilities in my life, which me as a man, I cannot change. Because what Jesus was saying there, put it back up there, Marianne, that scripture, those things which are impossible with man is possible with God. The things you cannot do in the natural, God can do it. Church, and listen to me this morning, if you can get this in your mind, because listen, we have impossibilities like sickness. Is there anybody here that can heal cancer in the natural, in your natural ability? No, you cannot. You cannot heal cancer. No doctor can heal cancer. Let me tell you something. Only a way cancer can get healed is through the power of God. Even, yes, God can use a doctor. He can use stuff. But you and I, in the natural man, we don't have the power to do that. Can you really fix people's finances? No, we cannot. There's things that are impossibilities in our lives. And this morning, think about some of those impossibilities in your life. And isn't it time that we start saying, God, I cannot do this? And isn't it better just that we just step aside and say, God, there it is. Fix this for me, please. Because, well, what do you and I do? Can we go home and then flick through the television and do nothing? Unfortunately not. But before we carry on, I went and looked up the word possible. I like doing this. I went to the Greek and I looked what the word possible means. Because if you just look at that scripture, it says that what is impossible for man is possible for God. That I cannot do, God can do. I said, God, give me some oomph in this scripture, if I can put it that way. And God said, look up the word possible. You know what the word possible in the Greek means? Dunamis. Dunatos. And that means power, strength, might. With me. Possibility. So basically, if you put the Greek words into that scripture, it reads like this. The things which are impossible for man, the things that you and I don't have the power, the might, the strength, the authority to do is possible for God. God's got the power. God's got the might. God's got the strength. Nothing. In Luke chapter 1, verse 37, it says, is anything impossible? Marianne, Luke chapter 1, verse 37. It says, is there anything that's too hard for God? Is anything that God cannot do? Are you with me, baby? Come on, blondie. I told you I'm going to whip you. But she's a real blonde, so I can call her blondie. Luke chapter 1:37. Nothing is impossible for God. There is nothing that God doesn't have the power not to do. Somebody just say, uh-huh. I mean, can you save your husband? No. Can you save your children? No. God can. Thank you, Lord. What is our part in this? So this morning, let's quickly have a look. How do we get the impossible to the possible? If you have an impossibility in your life this morning, how does that become a possible? That how does cancer get healed? How does a mixed up marriage that's on the brink of divorce get healed and restored? How does a financial poverty bankruptcy become blessed that you can have money again and keep on going? How does an addiction of your children that's on drugs, how does that become released and your child is set free? How does that impossibility become possible? What do you and I have to do? Because unfortunately, the church has become people are just sitting on the pews thinking, well, God's got to do everything for me because Jesus died and I don't have to do nothing. Unfortunately, the power and the anointing and the might and the strength of God that makes all things possible has got to work through you and I. We are on earth. Jesus is not on earth anymore. Remember when that scripture when Jesus said, I'm going to my Father. As the Father sent me, I am now sending you. What did God send Jesus to come and do? To heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, get people saved. Jesus said, as God sent me, now I'm sending you. We are now the disciples on earth. We are supposed to go out here and heal the sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead, witness to the people, tell them to come to church, get them saved. We can't save them. God's got to save them, but we got to do something. The power of God's got to work through us. It doesn't just float in the air somewhere. Am I right? Okay. So, for with God, nothing will be impossible. There's not a situation that God doesn't have the power to change it. What do you and I have to do? We got to have faith and believe that God can do these things. If you have an unsaved husband, well, listen to me, my sister. You can do whatever you, if you don't believe God can save your husband, what's the use of it? If you don't believe God can heal your body, don't even try. In Mark chapter 9, verse 22, they brought a mute boy to Jesus, a boy that couldn't speak. And this mute spirit would take the young man, throw him on the ground, and he would vomit and he would foam in the mouth and throw him into the fire and convulsions and stuff. So they brought him, this man, to Jesus' disciples, and they couldn't heal the young man. So when they brought the boy to Jesus, I'm telling you the story, Jesus said to them, they said, Jesus, why couldn't your disciples heal him? And Jesus said, oh, you of little faith. They couldn't believe that they could do that. And then he says, you're always looking for signs, but let me tell you something. Father, what is wrong with this boy? And the father told Jesus. And then look what he says in verse 22. He says, often he has thrown him both into the fire, into the water, and to destroy him. And then they say to Jesus, Jesus, but if you can do anything, I want you to get this, have compassion on us and help us. You know what Jesus says to them? If it was 2014, I can hear Jesus saying, uh-uh, nope. If you can believe, all things are possible for those who can believe. So if you have an impossibility, can you believe that God can do this, man? Is God mighty enough, powerful enough? Yes, he's got the might, he's got the power, he's got the strength to heal any sickness, release you from any addiction, fix your marriage, fix your finances. Well, does that mean we're always going to be living in and glory, glory? No, we're going to be attacked like me with my wife. When the devil attacks my wife, what do? I'm going to do exactly what I'm preaching to you today. I cannot heal my wife, so what am I going to do? So I'm going to believe God to do it for me. What do I do? What is my part in this whole process? God's given us five power tools. Can I quickly explain them to you? Five power tools that you and I got to use when we have an impossibility. If someone's unsaved, if your husband's unsaved, or your children, or there's sickness, or there's financial problems, how do you treat this thing? Number one, the first power tool that you make use of is the precious, mighty, powerful name of Jesus Christ. Are you using that name of Jesus as a power tool? or is it just another cliche? Why am I saying this? Because the name of Jesus is so powerful, listen, guys, that at the mention of that name, in Mark chapter 16, verse 17 and 18, Jesus said, he said, these signs will follow believers. In my name, demons will flee. People will speak with new tongues. They'll take up serpents. They'll drink anything deadly. By no means will it hurt them. They will lay their hands on the sick and they will be healed. Mark chapter 16, verse 17 and 18. In the name of Jesus. If you go to Philippians chapter 2, verse 9, 10, and 11, it says, there is no other name by which I... Come, where's my... Am I going too quick for you? Okay, go to Philippians. Let me let them read that for you. I just want you to see this. God gave Jesus the name which is powerful than any other name. That at the mention of the name of Jesus, listen to me, everything in heaven, everything on earth, everything under the earth must bow down. Are you with me? And the Christians are not understanding this. In Africa, we see this. When we say Jesus, boy, every cancer has got to bow down. Poverty has got to bow down. At the mention of the name of Jesus, everything in heaven, the Bible said, everything on earth, everything under the earth has got to bow down. So are you using that name of Jesus? Are you using it so that you can speak to that impossibility? When your husband's unsaved, what do you say? Ah, well, the old bag will most probably die unsaved. Or are you going to say, no, in the name of Jesus, my husband is going to get saved. When your son's on drugs, you say, well, he's just like his old grandfather. He'll just be a druggie. Or are you going to open your mouth and say, no, in the name of Jesus, that drugs will go away from my child. God will save my child. Are you using that name? Why? Because the name is so powerful. Are you with me? In Acts chapter 4, 12, it's the only name by which you can get saved. That's what the Bible says. There is no other name that can save you. You still battling? Randy, do you want to help that blonde? Okay. All right. It's okay. We're just going to carry on. Philippians chapter 2, I want to see them coming up. I know they know the scriptures, but I mean, I just want them to see that quickly. So it's just easier. And I'll talk to you. Acts chapter 4, 12, it says that there is no other name by which man can get saved. In Acts chapter 3, verse 16, while you put up the Philippians there, Peter healed a man. And they came to Peter and said, whoa, you healed the crippled man? He's got up. Peter said, whoa. It's not me. It's not nobody. In the name of Jesus, having faith, believing the name of Jesus, this man rose up from his crippleness. No other name. So come on, we get saved, we get healed in the name of Jesus. You get set free in the name of Jesus. Proverbs 18:10 says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are saved. That name helps you. It protects you. Am I right? What's your name, brother? Edgar. Let me show you how it works. Edgar comes to me and he says, Hansie, your music was too loud. So what, Eddie boy? Who are you? You're just a doorkeeper. I don't care whose husband you are. I don't care what you say. Who are you? You aren't come tell me my music's too loud. But guess what? Edgar comes and he says, Hansie, Pastor Ken said, your music's too loud. You know what I'm going to do is, Randy, can we just put that music down a little bit? Why? Because he used a name that's got authority. Are you with me? Pastor Ken is the pastor of this church. He's in control here. So if he comes and tells me, if Edgar says to me, put your music softer, who's Edgar? But Pastor Ken, that name, I know, that's the main cat in this church. So understand, there's power in the name. When you're driving down the highway 90 miles an hour and your wife bumps you, says, hey, slow down. You say, shut up, woman. And then all of a sudden behind you, there's another car doing 90 miles an hour, but he's got disco lights on top of his car. Different color car, and on the side it's written police. Guess what you're going to do? You're going to slow down. Yes, officer. No, officer. Why? Because that name police has got authority. Now, the same with the name of Jesus. Are you, listen, don't just, you see, the Christians are using the name of Jesus as a cliche. Oh, God and Jesus. No, you've got to start using that name as a power tool. Are you getting what I'm saying here? People aren't using that thing. They aren't coming and say, in the name of Jesus, cancer, you got to go. That's why we pray in the name of Jesus, because there's power in. I use that name as a power to not just, hey, you've never heard people say, oh, Hare Krishna, but it's hot. They use our God's name. They use our Jesus' name, even as a cuss word. You never say, in the name of Hare Krishna, be healed. They're always saying, people cuss in the name of Jesus because there's power in that name. We went to a church. A young girl comes out. I said afterwards, is there anybody that needs prayer? The mother comes up with a 14-year-old young girl. She walks like us. And I said, okay, oh, ma'am, what do you want? She said, well, my daughter had a stroke. 14 years old, have a stroke. This hand of hers was so tight, I couldn't open those fingers like us. I said, so what do you want me to do? She said, I want you to pray that God will heal her. I'm thinking in my mind, no problem. I've seen God heal people. I know God can heal. And the lady said, but, Hansie, I've first got to tell you something. I said, okay. She said, well, she doesn't like you. That's a good start, am I right? I've got to pray for you, but you don't like me? She said, step number two is she doesn't believe God can heal her. I said, man, this is getting better and better. So she doesn't like me. She doesn't believe God can heal me. So how do I pray for you? I mean, there's no faith. There's no nothing. So I said, ma'am, why did she get the stroke? She said, I don't know. She said, but let me tell you why she doesn't like you and why she doesn't believe God can heal you. She said, because we were watching television, and you got to watch out who you watch on television, please. She says, this guy comes up and says, if you can send me $1,000, God will heal any sickness. She says, and my little 14-year-old girl wants to be healed from the after effects of the stroke. Can't move her arm, can't open her hand, nothing. She said, so we go around knocking on doors, collecting money and asking people, we need money so we can get healing. They get the $1,000, they send it in, thank heavens. I was going to ask the lady who it was. Then I thought, no, I'd better not ask because I would sin big time if I found out who it was. So I said, I don't want to know who it was. And she said, but we collected the money, got the $1,000, sent it into the television program for this person, and here she is. She's not healed. So now you understand why she doesn't like people like us, because she doesn't believe us. Boy, in my head, I'm going, God, how do I pray for this young girl? What do I do? And I just get the answer, don't pray for her. I said, God, come on. The whole church is looking at me, and this woman wants me to pray for her. You say, don't pray for her. He said, don't pray for her. Put up your hand like this. I said to the young girl, I said to her, I had to get her to the point where she believes that God can heal her. In the end, and she just looks at me like this. She had eyes like you, brown eyes. She looked at me like this all the time. Then I look away from me, and I felt uncomfortable. This young girl was just checking me out. I said, do you believe it? In the end, I got her to say, mm-hmm. I believe God can heal me. But she still doesn't like me. So I listened to my brother. You know what I do is? I said, God, what do I do? God said, just say my name. This is the truth. You can call my wife right now. So this, he has this young girl like this. Put my hands like this. Leslie, this is the truth. And all I did was just say, Jesus. Jesus. Jesus, and I'm thinking in my head, come on, Jesus, I'm saying Jesus, you got to do something, Jesus. And I'm looking at this girl, and she's checking me out. Now, for 2 minutes, all I said was, Jesus, Jesus, and I'm thinking, oh, God, this is going to be so stupid. Jesus, Jesus, and you will not believe this. It was after 2 minutes that hand starts opening up, that arm stops going out. And the girl looks at me, and her eyes are big, and the congregation's eyes are big, and my eyes are big. And I'm looking at this girl, and that hand opens up, and that young girl gets her healing right there. Just by saying, I know some of you saying, oh, come on. You can call that pastor right now. That young girl is still, she's healed completely. All I did was just say, Jesus. I didn't ask God to pray or heal or nothing, because that's what God said. That name is powerful. So if you've got an unsaved husband, if you've got sickness, use the name of Jesus. Are you with me? It's better than saying, well, God cannot heal me. Oh, I don't know if God can fix my marriage. I don't know if God's going to get the job. No, sir. In the name of Jesus, it can happen. Are you with me? But you've got to have faith in that name. Got to have faith in that name. Everybody with me? How's our scriptures? Are we still not there? Huh? Okay. Faith in his name. That's how we, that's when Peter, go to Philippians 2. I just want them to see that. Philippians 2. That Philippians 2 is giving me a hard time. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9, 10, and 11. Therefore, God also highly exalted Jesus and given him the name which is above every other name. Hare Krishna, Ra, you name all the other gods that they are. So he said that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those in heaven, those on the earth, and those under the earth. And that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Are you getting this? Nothing can stand in front of that name. That name is powerful than any other name. Are you using that power? How does that power work? Out of your mouth. You've got to speak it. Come on, guys. Say, uh-huh. Right. Second power that you got to use, that God's given us, you all know this, is the blood of Jesus. Come on, the blood of Jesus has got power in it. Why? Well, when Jesus died on that cross, his blood was shed for us, and what did it do? It took away all your sins, and it heals all your diseases. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, come on, go there quickly. Now I know she's got everything hooked up, I believe. Okay, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, guess what? We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. Don't tell me that that's not power. The blood that can wash away your sin, that is power. Are you with me? If Satan had known what the blood was going to do, he would never have crucified Jesus. Because now when you and I sin, what do? Lord, please forgive me. When you get saved, Lord, please forgive me. And the blood comes and washes away everything that I did, every sin that I did. That is power. Are you with me? Now, can I use that power? In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, it also says, in him we have redemption through his blood. We are bought back from hell, from Satan, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. We are redeemed, brought back out from the claws of Satan through the blood of Jesus Christ. In Revelation chapter 12, verse 11, it says, we are overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. Hey, you've got to start using the blood. So why, how do you use the blood? When you take communion, what are you doing? Jesus said, every time when you drink the blood and you eat my body, you remember what I did for you on the cross. You remember that Jesus died for your sins and for your sicknesses. So what I do is I apply the blood that God has supplied. Remember when the Israelites, God said to Moses, take a lamb, take the blood, take the hyssop, and put the blood on the doorpost. That was the Old Testament. And when the enemy comes, a spirit of death comes through there, it'll bypass you. Why? The blood protected. So what do I do in the New Testament? I've got the blood of Jesus, not the blood of a lamb, but the blood of the Lamb. Behold, the Lamb of God. Jesus. Now I take that blood of his and I say, Lord, I apply the blood. I say, Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. Because whatever you're trying to do in my life, I'm covered by the blood. I told the people last night, we have every time when me and my wife get into that truck, into that big RV, what do? We say, Lord, cover our whole rig with the blood of Jesus. Because what other protection do I have? I speak the blood over it. I say, in Jesus' name, I am protected by the blood of Jesus. So now we're driving 70 miles or 65 miles down the road, come to a small little town, slow down to 35 miles per hour, big blowout. Oh, and I pull over the road. It wasn't a blowout. My whole tire, broke off the axle. If I had been doing 65 miles an hour, that thing would have rolled. And guess what? Me and my wife could have been dead. But the blood protected me. Does that mean nothing's going to ever go wrong? Uh-uh. Does it mean we'll never get sick? Uh-uh. But I have the name and I have the blood to speak against that situation. If I don't have that, then I will die. Understand what I'm saying? But I have the power of God. Now, you have an impossibility. Your husband's not saved. In the name of Jesus, my husband is going to get saved. I speak it. I believe it. Lord, cover my husband with the blood that he will be saved. Send people to talk to him. He's going to get saved. Are you with me? There was a missionary who went to Africa, and there was chickens running around. And on the chickens' backs were red ribbons. So the missionary said to the chief of the little village, what's up with the red ribbons on the chicken's back? He said, oh, that's to keep them safe. He said, you know these big birds, the hawks? What do you call them? Hawks, whatever. And the real English word is a hawk. Lord, please heal their mouths so they can speak proper English. These big hawks. He says, when the big hawks come, they catch the chickens. He said, when they see the red ribbon, they fly away. The missionary says, you're joking. He said, no, we've tried yellow, blue, black, white, and the hawks catch them. But the moment we put a red ribbon on there, the hawks leave them. I said, man, tie a red ribbon round my, I don't care. Boy, if you see, in the spiritual realm, the devil, when he says, sees the blood and you're covered by the blood and you've applied the blood. Listen, I apply the blood to the doorpost of my heart. I am forgiven. I thank God for the blood of Jesus every day. That's why we take communion, guys, to speak it out of your mouth. Say, Lord, I apply the blood over the situation. I'm talking about your impossibility because you want it to become possible. Whatever is impossible, God's power is going to make it possible. So God's power is his name. The blood is his power. Amen? Number three, the word of God. Romans chapter 1, verse 16 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, Paul says. You see, some of you are looking at me saying, why are you rumbling all these scriptures out and you're not even looking there? How many times have you preached the sermon? That's not the case. I know these scriptures. Do you know why? Because when they take away the Bible from me one day, it's right here. See, some of us know every little detail of every one of the San Francisco 49ers. We know their names. We know how many times they've scored. We know every baseball player's name, how many runs they've done, but we don't know scripture. Come on, don't be angry with me. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, Paul says, because it is the power of God unto salvation for the Jew and for the Greek. You know what? That word in your hand is the power of God to save people. The word salvation, I told people last night, is soteria in the Greek. It means to get saved, healed, delivered, set free, be prosperous in all things, whole, complete. So the word says there, Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the power of God to get people saved, get people healed, get people prosperous, to make them whole, to make them sound, to deliver them. That word will help you in everything. Get it into you. It's the whoop, whoop, sword of the Spirit, Ephesians chapter 6, 17. Pluck it out, whoop, out there and say, come on. Let's see what you can do, devil. Because when you quote the scripture, the devil cannot touch you. Because the power of God is stronger than anything else. But Hansie, what you're saying? I'm saying, if your husband's not saved or there's cancer, what do? In the name of Jesus Christ, I apply the blood over the situation. And now the word of God, whoop, says, if it's sickness, I'm healed by the stripes of Jesus. If it's money problems, God will supply all my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. I'm a tithe payer. I pay my tithe. God's going to bless me. If it's your husband not saved, the word of God says, God wants all men saved. And you speak the word of God over the situation. You apply the power of God. And what does the devil do? Say, oh, man, how do I fight the word? How do I fight the name of Jesus? Because when you say Jesus, every demon's got to go. I just read it to you this now. Everything in heaven, on earth, underneath, has got to bow down. If you believe it. The word of God is so powerful that you can use that sword. You can take it up. You can use it. In Jeremiah 23:29, it says, is not my word like a fire, says the Lord. Jeremiah 23. Okay, she's doing good. Don't shoot her down. Is not my word like a fire, says the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces. That's the word of God. In Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, God says to Joshua, he says, Joshua, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. You see, I quote the scripture every morning. I say, Lord, your word will not depart from my mouth. He said, your word will not depart, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. You shall meditate in it day and night. That means you shall read it, you shall study it, you shall speak it, you shall believe it. That's what it says. Okay, so that you may observe, look, see, to do what is written in it. See, that's why some Christians don't have any prosperity, success. Remember when I say prosperity, it's not bucks. Prosperity is not only money, all right? Prosperity is having a good job, having a good marriage, having physical, spiritually, emotional, prospering, and money, yeah, but it's not just money. It says, because then you will observe to look to do what is written in it, and then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. We have a golden key to be prosperous and be successful, and guess what we do? We learn all the football players' names. We know every worldly song that we can know, but we can't sing the Christian songs off by heart. Don't get angry with me. We don't know scriptures, but we want success. Does that make sense? Hey, I preach a little bit different because I'm from Africa. I can do that. I don't know about you, but I want to pluck out the sword. I want to apply it to the impossibility. And that word of God is so powerful that it can change everything so it can become possible. I can say with my mouth, sickness. Every day, guys, I do this. I get up in the morning. I say, the joy of the Lord is my strength. If God is for me, who can be against me? He'll never leave me nor forsake me. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Every tongue arise against me, judgment I condemn. What are you doing, Hansie? I'm taking my gospels. And then right after that, my wife gives me my vitamin A, my vitamin B, my vitamin C, and I take my vitamin pills. But I also take my gospels. It strengthens me. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. That's where my power comes from. And I have the name of Jesus. I have the blood to protect me. And I have the word as my sword. Whoop, whoop. I walk around and I can swing that sword anywhere because the scriptures come out of my mouth. If something goes, when that thing broke off of our trailer, pow, there we are stuck in the middle of nowhere. The first thing that came out of my mouth is, thank you, God, you are more powerful than this thing. You will fix this for me. You will get me out of here. And I'm looking at that, I'm thinking, I don't know, how are you going to do it? It's impossible for me, but thank you, God. You said things that are impossible for men. You got the power, and we got out that day, and God fixed it. And, well, it cost me $3,500. Who cares? I'm alive. My wife's alive. So what do you do with your wife, Hansie? Same thing. In the name of Jesus. My wife was doing so good, she was back on the stage with me and fell again a month ago. What did the devil do? Just trick us again. So what do? We just start all over again. Or I give up. I don't know about you. I'm not going to give up. I'm going to fight again. I fight the good fight of faith because I'm the righteous. You and I are the righteous. We live by trusting God, putting our faith in God, believing God he can. What do? You use the name. You use the blood. You use the word. Number four, fourth power, the Holy Spirit is your power. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus said to the disciples, the last words that he said to them, he said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Are you with me? So you can be a witness to me in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and in Roseville. The end of the earth means everywhere else. You see, you can have the power to go out there and be and imitate God. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 1 says, be imitators of God. Imitate Jesus. Do what Jesus did. If we start doing that, you see a different church. But you know what the problem is? Don't get angry with me. The most Christians don't know what the Holy Spirit power is. And I've had Christians say to me, you keep on telling me I got to use the Holy Spirit power. What? How do I use the Holy Spirit power? Well, first of all, you've got to realize that the Holy Spirit is not a Casper the ghost. He's the paraclete, the one alongside you. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. God's power lives inside of you. The Holy Spirit lives inside of you. He's a person. He just doesn't have a body. And you become his body. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So what is the power of the Holy Spirit, Hansie? Well, if you look at Galatians, there's three powers that I found out the Holy Spirit, how the Holy Spirit power works through me. In Galatians chapter 5:22, it said the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faith, and self-control. Those nine fruit, they are powerful. They are given to you by the Holy Spirit. Come on, is love powerful? Yeah. If somebody does something to you and you can say, it doesn't matter what you say, doesn't matter what you do, I love you. That's power, man. When you can forgive somebody that did something wrong, you say, I forgive you. That's power. Where some people cannot do that. When that situation doesn't rule you or reign, you forgive them. Love covers a multitude of sins, the word says. Love is so powerful. Joy. The joy of the Lord is my strength. That's power. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. When you could be kind and gentle to people instead of getting angry and bitter and full of hatred, that's power. Come on, young people. When you could have self-control and you could say, no, I'm not going to sleep with you. I'm 16 years old. That's power. When you could say the word no and you could say, I don't want a drug. I don't want to sleep around. I don't want to do that. That's power. When you've got control, self-control, come on. The gifts of the Holy Spirit. When you've got discernment, when you've got wisdom and knowledge, you can stand in front of people and God tells you something. That's power. Faith, the prophetic, the gift of healing, the gift of miracles. That's power. You with me? The third power that the Holy Spirit is. Remember when Jesus came to the tomb of Lazarus? Lazarus? What is it now? Lazarus. And he said, take away the stone. What did he say after that? Lazarus, come forth. He never said, oh God, I beg you to raise Lazarus from the dead. He never did that. What did he do? He said, Lazarus, come out. See, that's the power of the Holy Spirit, that commanding power. Now, I know some of you are saying, Hansie, I'm not used to this. But guys, when you're in Africa and you have an aged person in front of you and you got to pray for this person, you got to speak to that sickness. You got to speak life into that person. You got to use the name of Jesus, the blood of Jesus. The word says, whoop, you are healed by the stripes of Jesus. Now I command you, sickness, get out of this man. You have to do that because that's the power of the Holy Spirit speaking to that situation in that person's life. And that thing must got to go. I've seen it. I've seen miracles after miracles by speaking life. But you've got to believe that the name and the blood and the word, whoop, has got the power, and you got to believe that when you, God has given you the authority, like Jesus said, woman, you are loosed from your infirmity. And the woman straightened up. He looked at the blind man, go, your faith has healed you. Understand what I'm saying? Lazarus, come up. The little girl that was dead, rise up. Talita, rise up. He just commanded, he spoke it. Who did it? The Holy Spirit power. We have the same power. Some of you don't believe it, but you have the same power that Jesus had. You got the same Holy Spirit that Jesus had. He's not a different Holy Spirit. Why are you so quiet? I should take all of you to Africa that you can see this stuff happen. Pastor Ken, can I tell them about that guy or is it too much? 2 weeks ago, we're in a church like your size church. Guy sitting right here. We do the praise and worship. The pastor comes up. He takes up the offering. Before he takes up the offering, another pastor that's sitting there comes up and says, we got to pray for that guy. The guy sitting right there shaking like this. Like he's got fever. I'm up here. So I said, okay, let's go pray for him. Sitting right here. Now I do this. I say, hey, Jeff, what's wrong with you? Just shaking like this. Sitting right here. And he'd just come from Iraq or Afghanistan. Big, strong soldier. And the next moment he looks up at me like this. Now you don't have to believe this. He goes like this. He goes, ooh. Oof. And me, I thought, this demon's going to whip me. So I got to get off here. Get the guy out here. This guy had a demon inside of him. This is the truth. Big, strong guy. So what do you do? Now some of you say, I've never seen this. Some of you will be upset with me. But Jesus said, we got to go and do this stuff. Yeah, but Hansie, you're a missionary, you're an evangelist. No, we are believers. We can all do that. So what do? I say to the man, hey, we got to help you. We got to pray for you. What do? How do I pray? I say, in the name of Jesus, the blood of Jesus is against you. I actually asked the guy, who are you? And this demon spoke to me, saying, shh, I'm a Shakaida. I said, I've never heard that before. Mashakaya. The people in the church has been like us. I said, okay, in the name of Jesus, I command you, demon, loose the man. And the next moment he goes, fah! He falls forward on his face, on his pow, on the ground. Comes up like us, and sorry to say this, and pukes the red, slimy stuff like us on the carpet, the poor carpet. But guess what? The guy gets up there and looks around and says, where am I? What happened? And he's free. And starts smiling. And says, man, I don't know what happened to me. I told him, you said you're Morsakaya. He says, who's Morsakaya? Doesn't know nothing what's going on. He had a demon which he most probably picked up when he was in Iran or Iraq or wherever they were. Do you believe this stuff? If you don't, come with me to Africa. Let's go to just Oklahoma and I'll show you how it happened. It's there. What I'm trying to say to you is sickness, demons, finances, drugs, whatever. God can take the impossible and make it possible. We go to a little church down in Mississippi. If you ever go to Mississippi, those people are so laid back. Yeah, you all. I'm tired. I said, what? He said, I'm tired. I said, what's that? He said, I'm tired. He said, oh, you mean you tired? And they say, I'm tired. They can't speak down there. A woman comes out. She's 5 months pregnant. And she says, three sonars showed that it's a Down syndrome baby. So I said, okay, what do you want me to do? I always asked him, what do you want me to do? Because that's what Jesus did. What do you want me to do for you? That's what Jesus asked everybody that he prayed for. What do you want me to do? And they said, I want to see. Or I want to be healed. And they said, okay. I said, okay. Can we pray? You want the baby? They said, I don't want it to be a Down syndrome baby. I want God to heal the baby so it could be perfect. Okay. So we pray for her in the name of Jesus. Apply the blood. The word says that baby can be healed by the stripes of Jesus. And the Holy Spirit, I command you, Down syndrome sickness, go in Jesus' name. Okay. So So I say, ma'am, I don't touch women, but can I put my hand on your boopie? She said, yep. I said, I just want to speak to that baby. Now, you can speak to that baby. That baby will listen to you. It's in the spiritual realm. So I put my hand there. The moment that I put my hand there, that baby kicks me. Kicks me on my thumb. Bah, bah. Now, listen to this. I said to the one girl, to the woman, can you feel that? The baby's kicking me. Listen to what she said. No, sir. The baby cannot kick. I said, why, ma'am? You said, because Down syndrome babies don't kick. Give me 2 more minutes. She said, Down syndrome babies don't kick. Man, can I tell them what I said last night? I've got 2 lines when I preach. A prayer line and a slap line. A slap line and a prayer line. And when she said, no, Hansie, the baby cannot kick, I once said, get in the slap line. Let me just whip you for a while. We've just prayed that God. I said, why doesn't the baby kick? I never knew this. She said, a Down syndrome babies don't kick. I never knew that. I said, but ma'am, you're telling me the baby won't kick me because it's a Down syndrome baby. Duh, we just prayed that God healed the Down syndrome baby. Get in the slap line. And then come for the prayer. So she said, oh, okay, I understand. I said, no, you've got to speak right. We prayed for the baby. It's kicking my thumb. It's still kicking my thumb. Okay. I said, say with your mouth, this baby is healed. So she said, my baby is healed. It's not a Down syndrome baby. I said, okay, go. You are healed. So she goes. Listen to this. The next morning, she wakes up, and that baby's kicking pow, 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 all over the place. You know what she does? She calls her mother-in-law. Mom, I'm having a miscarriage. I'm having a miscarriage. Because the doctors told her that if this baby starts kicking like this, then she's going to have a miscarriage. So they call the doctor. The doctor says, yeah, come in quickly. You're going to have a miscarriage. So they race to the hospital. The doctor's waiting there. And he said, well, just before we do something, let's just do a sonar to see how the baby's turned because this baby wants to come out 5 months. So he's doing the sonar. And he's doing the sonar. He's doing the sonar. And about the third sonar, he says, ma'am, I don't know what to say to you, ma'am. But I know I was the doctor that did the other sonars, and I told you it's a Down syndrome baby. But this is not a Down syndrome baby. You're not going to have a miscarriage. This baby is just alive. It's kicking. You don't have a Down syndrome baby. Bah! Listen to me, church. It doesn't matter what the impossible it is. God can do it and change it. Are you with me? Can I tell you one more story? Let me take up an offering. One more story. There's a woman sitting right there. I'm busy preaching. In the middle of my sermon, I look at the woman and say, ma'am, what's wrong with you? She said, I got fibromyalgia. I just need to tell you this. And this is not lifting me up. I want to tell you how God can take an impossible and make it possible. I said, come out. We pray for her right there. In the middle of the sermon, this woman starts, woo, woo. I don't know why she did that. I said, what's wrong with you? She said, no more pain. I don't have no more pain. I don't have no more pain. I said, okay, cool down. I want to preach. She said, but you don't understand. I cannot do this. I said, calm down. What's up? She said, I couldn't move my neck. Never mind the fibromyalgia. I said, why not? She said, because I got a steel plate in my neck. I walk around like this. So her friend says, yeah, she had a car wreck. And she's had a steel plate for 14 years. She walks around like this. And now she can bend her neck. I don't know how God healed her and what he did with the steel plate. But she's healed. So praise God. God heals her right there. Takes the impossible and makes it possible. She goes and sits down. Right next to her is her friend and a young man of 14 years old. I look at him. I said, are you okay? He said, yeah, that's my mother. I said, okay, so your mother's healed tonight. He said, yes, sir. He said, but I've never seen something like this. He said, we Baptist people, and we've never seen anything like this. I said, well, it doesn't matter, young man. Is your mother healed? He said, yes, sir. She couldn't move her neck. She is healed. I said, well, praise God. And I turn around. He said, sir. I said, what? He said, I got to get saved. I need to get saved. And the young man gets up right there. His mother gets healed, and he gets saved. Just because God took the impossible and made it possible because I was obedient by saying, in the name of Jesus, the power of the blood sets you free. The Holy Spirit power command you to be healed. And come on. And the word says, whoop, And God healed that woman. If you have an impossibility, go use your powers, okay? Give God a big clap this morning. Now, I know Pastor Ken's going to come up. But I'm going to encourage you before we leave that you can get saved and healed, okay?
Praise God, yes. Lord, we just thank you so much for Hansie and the ministry that you've given him, Lord. And Father, that he's here today to share and that lives have been touched, Lord. People may not acknowledge it, they may not recognize it, but their lives have been touched because the Lord's gone forth. Lord God, we pray that you can call upon these power tools during the week so we can put them to use because we all own them, they're all in perfect condition, the batteries are charged and ready to go. And yet so many tools that sit in our garage unused. And so, Father God, we pray that these wouldn't be tools that go unused, but tools that are used daily because daily you bring people to Nathan's mom this morning had a terrible pass out and had to go to the emergency room. Just so many, name by name. And Father, we come and we lift up Hansie to you and his wife, Jeanette.
Yep.
And Father God, Hansie's on a faith walk. He's on a faith run. He's on a faith race this morning, Father, where he's going from church to church. He stepped out in faith and paid for a plane fare and got here. But now, Lord, he depends. Comes before you humbly and with a need, a financial need, because without finances, the plane doesn't have aviation fuel, and the plane doesn't fly. And Father God, the lights are the gospel's free, but the lights cost money. And Father God, it does cost money for Hansie to go and bring the message from church to church and to the homes of believers as well, places where he stays. And Father, we come and I notice that we have quite a few missing this morning, Lord. Well, while we let the rest of us step up to the plate, I'll contact some of those folks who are missing. They'll put in. But, Lord God, we just pray that we can be generous with Hansie and with Jeanette. Jeanette's here with us, even though she's back home in Texas. But she's in our hearts, and we love her. And Father, they have a time, a special time of need, and Lord, we come and we ask that more than ever before, we will be able to help them. And every time he comes, every time they come, they leave blessed by this church. Lord. And we pray that this be no exception. And so we lift up the offering that we're going to give, Lord, unto you. And Father God, that we can just come through and do our part, and knowing that we will be blessed because we gave. And not only that, but there will be eternal blessing because Hansie will continue on the journey, the voyage that he's on, the mission of this time, Lord, in October of 2014. And Father, there'll be those that get saved, those that get healed, and one day when we're all together in eternity, Lord, we'll be hugging and jumping up and down and saying, oh, yeah, we gave, and then Hansie had the money to continue forth, and people got blessed, and all because we were faithful as well. Because we're part of Hansie, and Hansie's part of us. We partner with them, and they're part of the work here at Calvary Chapel Roseville. And so thank you, Jesus, for giving unto you, and all the blessings put forth.
Before we go, I would just like to pray with you guys, just right there where you are. So just give me 2 minutes so we can pray and end off. And thank you so much for coming. Pastor Ken, we are okay with this morning. We're not. Okay. Do you want to try and do that? I don't know how many of them are going to come. Maybe they watch Dancing with the Stars. Tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, Monday night. We're going to have one more service. Right, yeah. We'll sing and we'll preach again. If you don't like my preaching, like what God says, then love me. You got to love me. Okay. Can I pray for you guys this morning? Would you all just stand if you don't mind? I would just love to do it. And just right there where you are, and just give me 2 more minutes, and then we can go home. I know the food's not going to run away. Let me ask you this morning. If you have an impossibility, you have sickness, you have unsaved family members, or you're battling with an addiction or with finances, just do a sign with your hand and just put it up to the Lord or whatever. Lord, I have a problem. You know what it is. And let me pray for everything. Is that okay with you? Because there's a lot of people. If you need individual prayer, come afterwards and I will pray for you. But I'm going to pray for everybody right now. Is that okay? Lord, in Jesus' name, by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ, the word of God says you want everybody saved. You want people healed. You want people delivered and set free and prosperous. So we are coming right now in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you that you will save every family members, husbands, wives, children, mothers, fathers, everybody that's not saved in our family members. Come right now, Holy Spirit, through your power and unction those people to get saved, to get turned around their lives and become born again. We thank you for it. We command those hindering spirits that are stopping our family members from getting saved to go away so that the Holy Spirit can work with them and convict them of their sin. They can come to church and get saved. Thank you, Lord. The people that are sick this morning, Lord, in the congregation, and people that are sick at home, we thank you that you died on that cross. Your stripes, by your stripes we are healed. That's what the word says. You are the God that healeth. You sent your word and healed our diseases. We take that, Lord. We receive that this morning. And we speak the word of God. And we command sickness to get out of our bodies. I am commanding every body, yeah, every physical body to accept wholeness, to accept healing, to reject sickness, and that this body of ours will not accept no sickness, no infirmity. We will only accept wholeness, completeness, and healing. That's what Jesus died for. So I command every person here that is sick, be healed in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you for that, Lord. Money-wise, Lord, people that need jobs, people that need financial blessings, thank you that they will give their offerings, they will pay their tithes, and you will bless them. Give us favor, God. Give us favor with God and favor with man. Give us good jobs. Give us good financial blessings. Not to go and have 5 homes and 6 boats and 20 TVs, but that we could just have a good life and bless people and help people. Bless us financially and prosper us as well. Spiritually, emotionally, physically, jobs, marriages. We ask you to prosper that, Lord, and so we can have good success in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Would you give the Lord a clap this morning? Thank you. Thank you for listening to me. Mo will be at the table. If you want to support us there, please, if you can, come tomorrow night. It'll be good, and we can enjoy each other again. Bring some people that are not saved. Give somebody a hug and say, I love you. And the CDs and the books are right there. You can go and support us. We will see you tomorrow night. Be blessed. The books are $10. The caps are $10, and the CDs are $15.